Okay, hello everyone. Welcome you all again for the seventh session today for the Optom online learning series. Today we have with us Mr. Purab Dalal. He is an optometrist. He finished his undergraduate studies from the Lotus College of Optometry, Mumbai, India. He then furthered his education by doing a master's optometry from the BMCO College of Optometry in Surat, and he's a gold medalist for his master's course. Currently, he's into private practice and he holds competency in contact lenses. And also, not only doing private practice, but he is a visiting faculty at some optometry colleges in Gujarat. So today, he's going to share with us about his ideas and his views on how we can make our practice more of a advanced practice where we can cater all our patients, and how it can be a specialist contact lens clinic. Focus is more on contact lens because his competency is on contact lenses, but nevertheless he has a lot of facilities available in his particular practice. So he's going to brief us about how we can make our own practice as a specialty practice. So go ahead, Purab. We are eagerly waiting for your suggestions and your inputs.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Dhin, sir, for a brief introduction. It was very, I'm very grateful to be a part of OOLS online optom learning series. So for today, my topic is upgrading your optometric practice to a specialty optometric practice, as it is told by Dr. Dhin, sir, that my specialty is more towards the contact lens. So my slide will go towards the contact lens more. So do I really need to remind ourselves our identity? So for that, optometrists, our definition of optometrists are the primary healthcare practitioner of the eye and the visual system who provides comprehensive eye and vision care, which includes refraction and dispensing, detection, diagnosis and management of disease in the eye, and rehabilitation of conditions of the visual system. This definition was given by World Council of Optometry, and we need to follow this definition in each and every part wherever we are working. So what are the role of an optometrist? Role of an optometrist are to prescribe spectacles in an optical outlet, although it should be more towards an optometric part. The dispensing should be good. Along with that, contact lens is a major role where we can play our own part as an optometrist, in which a rigid gaze contact lens and soft contact lens are also included. Along with that, dealing with complex cases like keratoconus, we can start our own specialty optometry practice. About binocular vision abnormalities, as well as vision therapy, especially in kids, and along with detection and diagnosis and management of ocular diseases, if to some level, and when the main role of an optometrist comes into the picture, when all the treatment plan of the patient fails, then we can also work as a low vision specialist. So an overview of optometry services in India, based on an online research conducted in a month by IBI in 2016, there are 800 retail optical chain outlets, 1312 specialty eye hospital, and 164 optometry institutes in India. So if we fragment this optical segment, 15% of the optical retail chains belongs to big box stores like GKB Opticals, Titan Eye Plus, Bonton, Vision Express, and other 85% of the outlets are mostly standalone and small shop, that is private optometry practice or private optical shop in local areas. So for that, the price is let us now talk about the present scenario of optometrists. The price is all, we are now in the era where the world lies in the tip of the finger, in the tip of your finger. There are a lot of marketing strategies developed by the online entities and the big box companies, they come up with so many offers that it becomes unwinnable fight to beat them in terms of price. But it doesn't mean that this cannot be solved. You can always improve your service with the three main key features, that is fastest, cheapest, and the quality services. I surely understand the online business are cheap as well as fast, but they have questionable quality there where you can beat them up. So as I explained the present scenario of optometric practice, I am now discussing what actually is missed if the practice is limited to an optical outlet. So usually optometrists fail in showing their qualification and expertise. They are not proactive to ask the patient about their complaints and why they have visited their optical shops. Just rather than making only a spectacle, there are many things which you can check for the patient's eye. Second comes the charge of consultation. There are barely any optical outlets where they take a separate consultation charge for the services. If you are qualified enough with your clinical practice, there will be no patient who will hesitate to pay for your consultation. The services in the optical outlets are less proactive. Lastly comes after that I just want to focus on this part of the topic where there you should always keep a distinguished area for clinical evaluation. Although if you are working in an optical outlet, you should have your separate testing area and a separate display area which includes your optical shops, optical display, or your product details. So distinguishing your clinical evaluation gives positive impact to your patient, and they feel like they are being treated by a professional eye care practitioner. Lastly comes the record keeping and the forms. Keeping good records will help you to use the data in so many ways. You can compare the improvement of your treatment plan, use it for research purposes, and so on. The optical outlets generally are found to have a poor record keeping system. So I hope I am now able to make you understand how does an optometric practice differ from a general optical outlet. So what are the prerequisites of an optometric clinic? I preferably would like to have a vision chart with a LED vision chart with which is available in LED system, because it includes so many of optotypes in local languages other than their logmar chart, as well as while testing pediatrics you can have pediatric vision chart also. The other thing usually students as well as new practitioner miss are getting a slit lamp in their practice. They don't invest in slit lamp. It is very necessary that you should invest in slit lamp rather than just investing in lensometer, autoref. That is also must, but the slit lamp also have its own benefit. You should design your own layout examination sheet, like shown in the slides, that you should design your own protocol for your clinic. I have my own examination sheet for normal patient, as well as I have my other sheets attached with it for the contact lens workup. Direct ophthalmoscope is very important to check undilated retinal evaluation, so we can refer patient if we see any underlying pathologies into the retina. So after coming towards this, we will discuss about the specialties which are available in optometry, that is pediatric optometry, geriatric optometry, cornea as well as contact lens, low vision and rehabilitation, ocular diseases and management, community optometry where you can enroll in many NGOs like Sight Savers, and you can do community eye care campaign also, vision therapy and neuro rehabilitation. As my area is of interest is cornea and contact lens, hence most of the slides further to come will relate to the contact lens practice only. So when to start a specialty with your specialty practice? The first thing that is essential setting up your specialty practice is a good command over your specialty. This could be achieved by if you have a good experience working in the specialty hospitals, as well as you have done fellowship in a particular training. Along with that, then you are good to go with the start. Along with that, basic amount of investment which is incurred in setting up a particular specialty, which includes the equipments as well as interiors or the trial sets which are involved in setting up your specialty practice. The goodwill of the clinic, and the practitioner himself also plays a key role in setting up your specialty clinic. If your general optometry practice is fairly good and patients are happy with your services, then it always advisable to start with your specialty practice. Last but not the least comes footfalls. Heightened footfall in your clinic is always helpful. Starting a specialty is always right if you have fairly good or increased footfall in your clinic. Keep in mind, failing to plan is planning to fail. So once you have chosen up your specialty, you have to decide on where exactly to start. So mostly it comes to two possibilities, hometowns and bigger cities. The first option is your hometown. Generally, since you belong to the same place, you will be aware with the number of practitioners which are practicing in the same specialty. Hence, the saturation of the practice and the amount of competition in that practice, in your area especially. Next is choosing your hometown is always good. It is always good if you have any familial issue. This can be either like you are the only son, daughter of your own family member, of your own family to take care of, or you have no option going away from the hometown. The third comes a familial legacy. The third is having a legacy in the practice. If you have someone who is into the same practice since long, hometown is always the best option. I will share my example with this. My father is also a diploma optometrist. He started his own optometry in his optical 20 years back. So I take the name of my optical shop and I have started my new optometry clinic in a new area. So it has helped me a lot in initial stage to get more of the patients. Other than that, bigger cities have more option of expansion, better collaboration, better accessibility. Nevertheless, I don't mean that when you are based on hometown, there is no chance of expansion. After all, those who have scaled up into chains now were someday a small standalone outlets. Like you can take an example of a Dhirubhai. He is working in Reliance. He has started from a small part of a Gujarat, and you can see him now. So once you are clear with when and where to start, you have to be careful about the following things that I'm going to discuss in this slide. Always start with a master plan. It will always help in better execution. Analyze the competition that you are going to face in your specialty. Seek advices from your elders, friends, or whoever are already into the practice. Always hire right people. It is not necessary that they have to belong to eye care only. People with a good management skills who are efficient enough to manage the appointment schedules are boon to your clinic. Always focus on the quality of care that you are delivered to the patient. Marketing is very must. Make a website that highlight your services provided by your clinic. Every start is come up with the possibility of failure and challenges. So be ready to face the risk. After all, smooth sea doesn't make skillful sailors, right? So the next slide is how do you establish yourself as a specialty. You should be educated. You should educate yourself and be proficient enough in that particular specialty. Be thorough with all the contact lens modalities which are available in the market, along with that which are the literatures and cut edge standard of care which is advisable with that contact lens. Especially I want to add one thing for fresh graduates or for students here, that if you are interested in contact lens, start your residency or internship, or you can join in any corneal sector, corneal hospitals, and also multi-speciality hospitals for developing your specialty. Now it comes to those who have already established and how they become, how they can become, they can become more famous. Join or start a local contact lens study group or national optometric study group. They can also join IACL, American Academy of Optometry, Contact Lens and Cornea, which they it, by the, establishing yourself as a diplomat in the same, because they provide degrees like PACL as well as FAAO, you can, it will be helpful to grow your practice. So third point, communicate with the community. You should inform your community, your patient, your friends about your interest in the specialty lens. Inform fellow eye care providers, including the ophthalmologists, about your new ventures. Cornea specialists are very helpful. Mark my words, I have been to this stage only because of the support of the cornea specialists around me. So they are your friend. They cross referral would help if you are have a good relation with the corneal specialist in your area. So taking on the challenges, so what is, how to take the challenges? It is essential to know that you are practicing no surprise approach to eye care. Sometimes success is realized immediately. Sometimes it takes few modifications to get there. Let patient know upfront that the specialty lens is fitting is a process. If at first you don't succeed, be willing to try something else. Explain your logic to the patient to keep them invested in the process, service, and the service you provide. Always keep them invested in something. Give them knowledge about what you are doing, because specialty lenses are time consuming. Sometimes it takes more than 3 hours also. So you should be proactive about that previously. Other than that, many of the more challenging cases, such as irregular corneal patient, are not particularly difficult. They often require diagnostic fitting relationship which don't look similar to your textbooks. So if your patient is improving well, vision is good and comfort is good, and there is no physiological compromise from the lens wear, then you can definitely go with that fit. I come up with such question from my students that, sir, this fitting doesn't look like a textbook fit. But whenever we check the patient vision with that fit, it is superb and there is no corneal compromise. So we usually proceed with that fit and ask the patient to come for follow-up. So coming up to why specialty contact lens. As you can see the slide, it develops a new revenue stream to your practice. Along with that, the patients who are your patient willing to go for refractive surgery are again your patient, because sometimes some of the patient develop complications which you need to treat with the specialty lenses. So there is a relatively growth in the population of the patient who are willing to go for refractive surgery, and because of that, topography scans and everything are done at an early stages. From that you get patients like diagnosed for keratoconus at a very early stage, and you can treat that patient with your RGP lenses also. So why specialty contact lens? There is a great power in a patient doctor relationship. If you are good at your clinical service, then you always succeed in keeping the patient satisfaction high. Then however higher you charges, the patient are ready to pay you and they don't have any objection. So always prioritize your quality of care over the monetary aspect of your service. That's what playing a loyalty card is. If you have a certain fellowship degree already with you, then you should definitely go with doing that practice, because it will enhance your practice as well as it will give you positive impact for your practice. So how do you scale up with your clinic? First, you should make connection with all the senior ophthalmologists with your same specialty, your friends who practices other specialty, and also with the patient. Cross referrals from other specialty is also helpful in scaling up your practice. If you connect well with your patient, they will always recommend seeing you to other patients. So don't keep yourself tight in making connection. Be active with your patient. Talk about their complaint. Learn to know what the patient wants from you. Keep your staff trained if they are optometrists, encourage them to go for seminars and workshops. Non-optometric staff should be trained for insertion removal also, which would be helpful if there are so many of patients waiting for you or there are so many of patients waiting for the evaluation. So just start up with, by the time you come into the picture, they just show them the initial examinations and initial insertion and removal. So what you should always update your office protocol, invest in technology. Mark my words, patients are very happy to learn about technology and they want it to try. If you show them something, they will be happy to try on them. So always show that this is my specialty, this is my new machine which I want to I want for specially fittings like yours, and they are happy to be with it. Educate about others, about your practice, especially your students or your fellow eye care practitioners, including optician also. So once you have an established specialty practice, how do you make sure to retain them? How do you educate your patient for optimized lens wear success? The first method is by the help of a handout. It is proved that the same message when verbally said and when visually expressed, we tend to remind the one that is visually depicted. The same applies here. No matter how many hours you are explaining verbally about the lenses handling to the patient, next time when you inquire, they will have an excuse that they forgot the procedure. It is necessary that along with the verbal advice, you present them with handouts. I am very much sure that they will be more compliant with the proper lens handling if you given a handout. Then comes optimizing compliance. Initially, when there are new patient to the new contact lens wearers, they tend to forget so many things. You can either call or keep reminding through mails and to see if they are doing okay with their contact lens. Follow-up visits are very important for any eye care services. Encourage patient to see you even if they don't have any complication as such. Educate them how essential it is see to the status of the lens as well as eye, even if you don't have any signs and symptoms also. Remind them follow-ups on messages, email, WhatsApp, whichever is helpful to you. So after all this, these are the equipments which are not compulsory, but it is necessary that you have such reports before starting your contact lens evaluation. As you all know, all are aware of the keratometer and everybody have keratometer. Mark my words, still so many people, so many students, so many opticians also don't use that keratometer before contact lens fitting. Only a soft contact lens requires also a keratometry fitting. It is very helpful whenever there is a cornea is very flat or very steep. Your daily disposables, your disposables which are available with fixed base coat don't work in every patient. Keratometry readings have a lot of power in it. So that can be help you to get a good fitting. Along with that, if you have a specular microscope for corneal endothelial cells, it is very, very useful. Slit lamp with an imaging system is always helpful for your patient because you can show what you are doing. You can show how the lens is moving on your eye. So you can show the tears exchange between the lens. So I advise you that if you have a slit lamp, then always attach a video camera or a photography slit lamp along with that. Then Pentacam, where you get all the readings in one machine. So what I generally advise my patient, already they are patients suffering from any corneal abnormalities. They have the reports with them. I just call them with the reports and check that the reports are recent only. Minimum of 3 months of 3 months old reports are okay with it. It is very old, then I resend again to the clinic and they get it done for me. So what are the potential candidates? Back to the basic: keratoconus, pellucid marginal degeneration, intact surgery, keratoglobus, corneal injury, RK, keratoplasty, post-LASIK astasia, severe dry eye, high astigmatism, progressive myopia, as well as aphakia. These all are potential candidates. Any candidate which are not working with a normal specialized contact lens or normal contact lens are your patients. So as you all know, going back to the basics, which are the specialty lenses which are available? Corneal GP lenses that are between of diameter between 8 to 10, then intralimbal GP lenses, the diameter between 10 to 12 mm. Scleral lenses are above 13.5 mm, which includes mini scleral as well as full scleral. Piggyback, hybrid and customized soft contact lens are also included in specialty. As I discussed earlier, that all patients are not fitted which are disposable at a particular fixed base scope. Therapeutic as well as prosthetic contact lens are also specialty lenses. Along with that, multifocal you can also add it. So minimum amount of trial sets which you require. First of all, I ask every of my students to go with your basic RGB trial set and do fittings on normal as well as specialty cases on initial stages. You will learn from it. Every patient is different. Every patient will fit differently. Then you can invest in mini scleral lenses, Rosca lenses, as well as you can take a bank of cost of contact lens trial also. So now it comes again a new interesting topic, that is recent advancement in optometry practice. So first picture is a diaton tonometer which is used with the contact lens. Patient is wearing scleral contact lens, then you can do IOP measurement with the contact lens on. Usually we need to do Goldman applanation tonometer with the context tonometer, so it doesn't work with the contact lens. Then the second is iPrint Pro, which is the latest technology designed for special complex fittings in which there is one blue colored dye which is inserted inside the eye. It takes the shape of the corneal curvature and the lens is designed automatically from that shape of the same measurements. Then the third is iLux. It is useful in treating meibomian gland dysfunction as well as in dry eye patient. It hits the block meibomian gland, so you can decrease the symptoms which are patients suffering from. So we have the links for this all instrument with the Fakhruddin. I will share with the Fakhruddin sir, and you will able to see it later on. So what are the must in the market? So how actually do you market about your clinical practice? The first is promoting to the people through advertisement in local radios, pamphlets, newspapers, conducting free camps, talk to other practitioner, ophthalmologists who specialize in anterior segment, then come up with the setting up your website with the website represent you and your practice. So make sure you hire a qualified web designer for it. Make your site robust with information of patients and doctors to encourage referrals. Highlight tour achievements in your practice and your research interest also, because if you are interested in contact lens, what you are doing currently, you should tell to your patients, so they may be interested in knowing about it in the future. So you should always give crisp clinical images on your website which shows your patient with the contact lens on. It is necessary to take prior consent before doing that. Referral left letters with the corneal specialist, make it professional. Like if you have any complaint related to cornea, just write it down on your referral pad with your name, with your designation written over it, and then refer to that doctor. Show about your recent achievements and qualification in the clinical area. I have seen that many of the patients have to wait long for specialty fitting. So my recent achievements, my recent qualifications are in the waiting area that they can just look around. So social channels, as all of you are online, they can see that you can brand your practice on all of this. I will not go in detail on this. So as it is a pandemic of COVID-19, I just wanted to discuss that if you start again a practice after this pandemic, then what things you should keep in mind. make my mark my words, there is no research up till now presented that the contact lens are the mode of transmission for COVID-19. So your contact lens patient can use that contact lens now also. So what the initial things you should keep in mind before you're starting your practice, you should always manage your patient. That you just ask the patient that if you have any history of foreign countries, they have visited to any foreign countries, or they have history of such viruses previously. Always disinfect your contact lens equipments and trial set. For contact lens equipments, you can use a sodium hypochlorite or with a 70% alcohol and normal disinfectants which are used in a hospitals. That is alcohol swab. It's also okay. Hand sanitization before checking the practice is very important, as all the news channel and all the newspaper are just promoting that you have to wash your hand every 10-20 minutes with a proper sanitizer. So it applies to the contact lens patient also. They need to disinfect their contact lens with all the disinfecting tools as well as care regimen which you are given with the contact lens. Always monitor your fellow practitioners which are checking your patient or which are indulged in your staff, because they may have a virus which can they can spread through to your patient also. So this is the basic idea which they have given, that a contact lens wearer infected in the form of droplets, they can transmit a disease to the practitioner also by two ways. By airborne is the first way, which we are, that's why we are wearing masks. Then we from a direct contact and also from a indirect contact lens through slit lamp also. One thing I missed here, that proper use of safety personalized protective equipment like N95 masks and the shields which you can see in the slide, which is helpful while checking the patient. This is designed by a group of ophthalmologists in America, and they have published paper over using of these screens in your practice also. So you can always go through it. So this we have discussed. So this is how I work in my clinic, that I have 1650 square feet area. The upper picture shows my display wall in which there are lots of amount of optical things which are there, frames, mirrors, as well as goggles, which I'm not least interested in that because I don't see any technical thing before prescribing a goggles. And the lower part is my clinic where there is a reception, there is one separate cabin. As I discussed earlier, you should do everything separately, clinical evaluation in one part of the clinic and display and dispensing at the other part. So I have divided my clinic in this way. This is a pamphlet designed by me for local newspapers as well as local channels, which is very helpful because it shows images rather than written in my local languages also. So images like I am checking the patient professionally like an ophthalmologist or an optometrist, or there is one picture of a sterile contact lens inside also. So they just keen what is this contact, how is this contact lens that much big. So by that means I promote my practice. So conclusion, enthusiasm in accepting the challenging cases is very useful. By that means you can be stand out of your crowd from your local optometrist practitioner or as well as local optician. Bringing up the satisfaction to your patient with enthusiasm in your practice, because this satisfied patient will give reference to the other, their colleagues, their friends, which will be very helpful in growing your practice at a vast scale. So thank you Prakrutin sir, thank you OOLS for my talk, and I am happy to help you or answer your question and answer in the question chat section. Thank you Prakrutin sir.
Thank you Purab for your very insightful presentation. So we have the question answer comment section. If you have any questions for Purab, please raise up your questions. There is one question, let's answer that first. So since you are into contact lenses, somebody has asked what contact lens do you recommend for dry eyes? Because they can have irritation or people can feel uncomfortable. So what's your take on the contact lens type you recommend for dry eye?
For dry eye, basically large diameter contact lens like mini scleral and scleral contact lens work well. In India, LV Prasad Institute have installed the setup for Boston lenses. So I call the practitioner from that site and they do the fittings for me in my clinic. So I don't have a trial set, but I have a mini scleral trial set of Roske as well as Atlantis, which I initially, so it doesn't work with well with that, then I refer the patient to such a specialty practice, or I call the specialty practitioner to my clinic.
Yeah, this is a very important point here, and I think you have made this clear in your presentation also. Don't be afraid of referring your patients, or don't be afraid of taking opinions from your fellow colleagues, because at the end of the day, you want your patient to achieve maximum outcome. So I think good that you, if you don't think any thing is happening from your side, better refer or better take opinion from your fellow friends. One more question is, how do you manage pediatric refraction in your clinics? Do you do cycloplegic refraction, or how do you manage that?
For pediatric refraction, I have a connection with local ophthalmologist. One of my family member is also an ophthalmologist, but he has a separate practice. So I collaborate with them, and when I just refer them initially, if there is a lot of amount of hyperopia, I refer them initially to them. They go dilated examination. They do dilated examination. Then that practitioner, then ophthalmologist send that patient to me. I do dry and wet retinoscopy, everything, do PMT also, all the refraction part, then I do the follow-up. That ophthalmologists have trust in me, and that's how I manage. And many of the old pediatric patients which are working, which are already into my practice since long, are happy to be tested by me. In that patient, what take, I will just give you one thing in this, that if your patient, if you can invest in a non-contact tonometer, especially if you are old patient, then you can check the IOPs before dilating. So as in India, there is a controversial part that you cannot dilate as an optometrist, but still you should have a good reference practice if you want to do cycloplegic refraction for your patient.
Yeah, so reference is a key. If you work very closely with ophthalmologists, it's a very advantage for your practice as an optom, because you need to refer them and they can refer you back. So what are your takes on how do you build up the reputation with the ophthalmologist, and do you visit their clinic and do freelancing, or what's your strategy on building up the reputation with the patient, with the ophthalmologist?
Very good question, actually. Since from 2016, I was starting this specialty contact lens practice. Initially, I used to take my RGP trial set to the ophthalmology practitioner, and then I work with them in their clinic. Obviously, I take consultation charges from that ophthalmologist. Sometimes some ophthalmologists pay, some denies, but I make sure that what is the deal before going there. So I do freelancing, but it is paid. And on the initial stage, if you have a new trial set, like when I invested in Roske trial set long back in 2017, I visited many of the corneal specialists as well as ophthalmologists with the trial set. And on the first visit, I told them that I can do a few cases just to show you that how this lens works. And from then, they build up the trust in me, and then they are referring me, or they just call me. I go there, I work there for a few hours, and if it is possible, we prescribe for them. But if it takes more time, then I request the ophthalmologist to send the patient to me, and then we look up.
Yeah, so the key here is you have to practice and you have to gain knowledge whether it's sitting at your office or whether you have to go to the ophthalmological practice and do the patients, right? So once you have the hands-on, once you have built the reputation with the ophthalmologist, once they are confident in you, I think they will refer back the patients to you. Yeah. And then comes the liberty. Now what you are doing after 4 years of struggle and practice, you are sitting at your office and treating the ophthalmology yeah. patients, ophthalmologist referred patients.
Yeah.
That's good. One more thing, one more question is, if let's say we are a fresh graduate, what do you suggest? Do you suggest minimum of waiting time before we start up the practice, or should we just start practice straight away? And what would be the investment like? What is your views on that?
If you are a fresh graduate, especially depends from where you have passed your graduation, undergraduation. So if you have passed from a well multi-speciality hospital like LB Prasad, Shankar Netralay, Lotus, then you have ample of amount of experience over this type of contact lens. So if you don't have ample of amount of confidence, then you should wait. As I have mentioned in the slide, you should visit your practitioners, you should do internships, you should do distance programs, some programs are LB Prasad have come up with, if I'm not wrong, that PGDOBS or something like that they have come up with. You can enroll in that, and you have to gain knowledge before starting this contact lens. And if you are not doing it, I will recommend you to do your basic RGP evaluation in your patient. For that, you need just a slit lamp or just an RGP trial set. So if it is not with you, you can invest in RGP trial set. Is not a more investment greater than more than 10,000 maybe. And if you start doing RGP, then you will get interested in speciality fittings and you can work more precisely. Along with that, as one patient was like a basic investment which I did in my clinic, right? So it was a especially huge amount of investment which required around 10 lakh for equipments, and for specialty lenses it was around more of another 2 lakhs. So at initial stage it is difficult, but if you are practicing in an optical, start with RGP lens, start with specialized soft lens, take advice of the senior practitioner, call them, attend workshop trainings, you can go well. Nothing big issue.
Yeah, attending
you
workshops
learn from
and training
each and every patient.
Yeah. That's wonderful, because I have seen you attending trainings, and remember one time when you flew down, or I think you took a train from one state to another to attend a one-day conference we attended together, Atlantis Scleral Lens, and then you went back the same evening.
Yes.
So just for that one day, if you can give your time, or that 6 hours you gave your time to come to another state to just learn how to fit in the lenses, that's commendable. So for your initial days, definitely you need that kind of commitment when it comes to training yourself before you put in all the investment in terms of finance and monetary this one. So yeah, that's good. And there's one more question. In terms of council validity to open up independent practice in India, there are many of those councils. So what is your take on it, and who should we approach to open up the practice, or from where should we get permission?
Where should we get the permission
to open up the practice? Is there any ideas on that? Who should we approach to get permission to open up the practice? Or what? How do we open up the practice?
If I am wrong, it doesn't require any permission to start a specialty practice if you have just passed your 4-year bachelor's program. Just you need that if you have an additional recognition like FIACL or any special, if you have worked in LB Prasad or institute like this multi-speciality hospitals, then you can go with it. It's not, you require any permission for that. You have done bachelor, that is more than enough. But
only for specialty. Opening a general optical shop, I think that's what the attendee is mentioning, just to open an normal optical shop, whether you have a specialty center or not, is there anything we need to consider, or there is nothing special about it?
Registering to such Optical Council of India (IBI) is always helpful because they share their new things which are coming in optometry. But it is not mandatory. I personally think that if you want to stay updated, if you want to know how many optometry practices are there, then you can join there. But I personally think that is not mandatory at all.
You can it's just an added advantage. I also second you for that. It's an added advantage because your practice will be actually listed in their websites, and then it's a public website, so people can know. The only thing is, I'm not really sure on what intakes of opening a practice or opening a shop. There are certain laws about it. I think you need to speak to somebody who is in the law firm. That do you need an additional license to open up the practice? That one, I think we have to leave it to the lawyer. But in terms of knowledge, where knowledge is concerned, the bachelor's degree is enough for you to start up the practice tomorrow. That's my take on it. Let's take one more question. There is one question, very, very interesting question. Like you said, you had a background of optician. You have your father as an optician, and then you have a family member as an ophthalmologist. So was it easy for you to set up the practice? And let's say if we don't have any background, is there any key tips you want to give us where people who don't have any background would benefit from that before opening the practice?
So you are pointing towards a specialty or a general optometry?
General or specialty, whatever. I mean, maybe we can answer both.
Okay. If you are planning to, if you are talking about general optometry practice, for a specialty practice, it's always helpful that I have an ophthalmologist background also and optical background also. Because we have good connection with many contact lens distributors as well as many ophthalmologists also, it was helpful to me at initial stages. But only my father only helped in reference. But how to build the trust for that ophthalmologist in you, it's in your head. So you have to you have to talk with them, you have to visit them regularly, you should talk about your skill, then only they will be interested in working with you. Other than that, if at all we forget everything, we forget about specialty right now, we start our own optical outlet, then I don't think that you cannot start an optical outlet without a reference, because starting an optical outlet doesn't require any special training. You can invest, you can make, as I have described in slide, that you should use slit lamp, you should use visual LED chart, and you should acknowledge your patient, and you should know what are the expectation of the patient from you. And if you work properly over it, then they are happy and they will recognize you as a professional eye care professional. And no any other thing is required. And then for specialty, you need more of connections, more of reference, everything. But at early stages, it is not mandatory.
Yeah, that's right. So
you have to stand out the as it was given in the a photo which was shared by Fakhruddin sir to all the attendees, that you have to stand out of the crowd if you want to work as an optometrist. You just don't end up doing the same thing which an optician are doing, giving a sale, doing publishing only your spectacles. Don't do that. As you can see in my slide also, in this photo, I have not explained anything about the brands which are included in opticals. It's just me, my qualification, and what I just want my patient to wear it. So I generally think like we should be brand, not brand should take over me. So yeah, that helps me a lot.
That's right. And The very interesting thing I saw that you put RGP lenses as a specialty lenses. Now, this is a very good take home message. I think RGP lenses are not specialty lenses, but why Purab has put there as specialty lenses is because we as optometrists, when we graduate, we don't do RGP lenses. We should be doing RGP lenses as well as soft lenses because we are learning that in our curriculum. Specialty lenses like rose-K, keratoconus fitting requires additional training. I do understand that, but don't forget that RGP lenses are the backbone also. Like, you know, you need to do RGP lenses as normal soft lens, and RGP is not a specialty. But I mean, you have made your point very clear. We forget RGP lenses, and then, you know, we just put disposable, we just put soft lens, that's it. That's our limit. We don't go beyond, we don't stand out of the crowd to fit our patients. So that's a very good point which you have made it clear today. Okay, thank you very much. I think there are a couple of questions, but due to lack of time, we would take them later and we would get back to them with some ideas and your opinion about how to improvise your practice and make it to the specialty. So once again, thank you very much for taking the opportunity and sharing your ideas, your views, your experience. And we were very happy, and it was a very fruitful session today.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Stay safe. Stay at home.
Stay safe. Stay home. Yeah, that's the important message before we all go. But before we all go, there's one more important message. I want you to share our speaker for tomorrow. So let me just share my screen as always. Yeah, so we have Mr. Monil Champaria. Yeah, sorry if I pronounced your name wrongly. I think I will learn it by tomorrow when I introduce you. So he is going to talk to us about the contact lens care and patient education. He's a student, and I'm very excited to listen to his talk because he has taken the initiative to, you know, come on this platform and share his thoughts about contact lens care and patient education. So we'll be waiting for you eagerly. The timings are mentioned, 11 a.m. same time India and 1:30 at Malaysia. And stay home, stay safe. See you tomorrow again. Bye.